title, you already have hopefully a handout. Did everybody get a handout called The Prayer for Forgiveness that we'll get to tonight, but also that you can take home with you? And the title of the teaching that the Sandfords give, John and Paula Sandford are the authors of the book I mentioned, which is Transforming the Inner Man, which is only one of four books in that series. So there's a whole bunch of material there. And I'm just going to start with 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The title of the teaching is called Accomplishing Forgiveness. And you might think, why not just say forgiveness? But we're going to get into that tonight, because many people will come to us in need of counseling. And we'll say, well, have you forgiven? Fill in the blank. Your mother, your father, your high school football coach, your music teacher. If you ever saw the movie Whiplash, it's about a psycho professor in a college, in a music college. So, you know, things, we get traumatized by things when we're growing up. And this guy had this one thing that he would do when he was not happy with somebody. He would do this, like, stop playing. You're messing up. And, you know, so many of us have had experiences like that. And it's part of our culture. But God has redeemed that in Christ. So this verse talks about that. All things are of God. 2 Corinthians 5:18. Now all things are of God, who reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Can you look at somebody and say, he has given us the ministry of reconciliation? So Lord, we thank you that your word is true. And we want to appropriate your word into our own lives tonight. And we want to be what you said we are to be here, ministers of reconciliation. It's easy to criticize. It's easy to find fault. It's easy to join the mob and not think too hard about our opinions. But that's not your way. You've made us ministers of reconciliation. So we accept that challenge. We accept that assignment, that we would be people who are pursuing. You said, as much as it's within our power, pursue peace with all men. Lord, so make that come alive in us tonight. That's 2 Corinthians 5:18. Now 19 says, that is, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. So you might wonder, well, how does forgiveness connect to reconciliation, right? Well, lack of forgiveness is pretty easy for all of us to understand, because we know how hard it is to forgive somebody that's hurt us, right? Say, right, help me out here. I don't think I'm alone in this one. Forgiveness doesn't come factory installed at the hospital in the maternity ward. It's a gift that we have to appropriate, like I said, from the Lord, because it's supernatural. And we know of some famous scenes that have happened in America, even in the secular press. I can remember one from when I used to watch football. I don't watch football anymore. But there was a player on the Dallas Cowboys that they were in training camp, and there were two rookie players that were there for their first year. And they went out and got drunk one night during training camp, which is not a good idea, obviously, if you're playing football. But boys will be boys. And there was a car accident, and the driver survived, but the passenger died. And the driver was convicted of manslaughter and had to go to jail. And when he got out of jail, the mother of the deceased boy, the son that died, invited the one who went to jail to her house for Thanksgiving dinner and said that she wanted to adopt him as her son. Can't even say it, right? This is how hard this is, right? Thinking, you're the one that took my son's life, but I want you to know that you were doing the best you could do. Like, you made a terrible mistake, I get it, but don't live the rest of your life with regret. There was another similar story, and when the man who was driving realized that the other person died, different story, the driver committed suicide, like right on the spot, just couldn't handle it. And this lady brought this man into her house and fed him. And the interviewer from the television network said, this is very unusual. Like, how did you find it, the capacity, the ability to be able to forgive the one who killed your son? And she said, well, I'm a Christian. You should have just known that as a Christian, that's one of the things Jesus empowers us to do. And I'm not quoting it verbatim right now, but she wasn't anybody who had gone to Bible college or had an MDiv or any of those advanced degrees. She was a lady that just was very faithful to attend church. She knew her Bible. And she said a very profound thing that, excuse me, I know what it's like to not forgive somebody, and that would just poison my system. So he didn't suggest to us that we forgive people. He told us we had to forgive people. If we expect to be forgiven, then we have to forgive other people. Right in the Lord's Prayer, right? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. As we forgive. So if we don't forgive the ones that owe us, then we won't be forgiven our sins, right? Pretty profound, important things. And really, to be a Christian, you have to understand forgiveness, because you couldn't be a Christian if you didn't realize you've been forgiven. It's the very core of the sinner's prayer is, Lord, I repent of my sin. I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? And he says, well, I don't know. Let me think about it. Send me your resume. One of my people will get back to you. The answer is yes to the thief on the cross right next to him. Lord, remember me. It's all he had to do was say, Lord, and it was enough of a belief in his heart, right? It's not by works, it's by faith. We have to just take it by faith that we are forgiven. And I love what Jen Ives said, that just as you believe by faith that you're saved, believe by faith that you're healed. They're equal. Isn't that powerful? You could be a Christian for 100 years and you still hear new things all the time, right? It's just that revelation. It's wonderful. So he's committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. So let's just think about what that means, right? I don't want to go too fast through this because we're representing the kingdom of God in the earth, which means we should have Christ-like behavior. And some of the exchanges on Facebook, you know, when people are flaming each other, does not feel very Christ-like, right? But I'm just speaking the truth. Maybe. But doesn't seem to be a lot of love in there. And people will hear you if they respect you and if you have a relationship with them, but if they don't think you have the authority to speak into their lives, they're not going to pay much attention, right? So we're ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. So that's the first one. The relationship is be reconciled to God. Hopefully when people look at us, and you know, there's many other famous stories, right? There was the shooting that happened out near Lancaster. I don't remember if it was Lancaster, but it was in an Amish community, right? And they were openly forgiving the people that killed their children. If I remember right, it was children that were killed. I mean, the world looks at it and just cannot grasp it. And we have to be careful that they're not looking at us and that we're just acting just like they would act, right? Because we're from a different kingdom. But we have to integrate it. We have to metabolize it. So the Lord is saying, if you're my ambassador, when people interact with you, they should be drawn to me. Because that's what an ambassador does, represents the home country. And the message that we should be giving them is, you can be forgiven, no matter how bad it is. I know you've got your front on because you want to impress people, but you can just let the guard down and let God know that you've sinned, because he loves you and he wants to forgive you. And he wants you to be reconciled to him. And then verse 21 is really what applies today. For he made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. Yeesh, in him. That's a mouthful, isn't it? I have this luxury of being a worship leader for the last 35 years, and this is a song that we used to sing, and then we'll bring it back again. So I can hear the melody to this. He made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. It's on a replay loop in my head. And it's so good to remind ourselves that The one who knew no sin became sin for us so that we could represent God's righteousness in the earth. The flawed human beings carrying in the cracked vessels of clay that we are, yet we're holding the glory of God. Isn't that amazing? Not because we're perfect. Even with the cracks, he allows us to hold the glory, but we have to yield to him, right? That word keeps coming up over and over. So again, I will give credit where credit's due. The Sandfords have written a lot of what we're going to be talking about tonight. So I'm going to go to a quote from John Sandford, but I want to just set up the scene for you of how we got here. And maybe I'll just start by giving you what the conclusion has to be, because we have to think about this and really decide whether we want to try to do what we're being asked to do as Christians. There's many biblical examples of people being surprised when they were forgiven. So let's just think about Jacob for a minute, right? His brother Esau was coming back, and he knew he was going to be confronting his brother, who had every reason to hate him. We could go into all the details of why, but I don't know. I think Jacob gets a little bit of a, I mean, Esau did offer to give him, you know, the birthright for a bowl of soup, right? So, okay, well, you know, you could say Jacob was a conniver, but Esau had a part in that, didn't he? Anyway, Jacob thought he was going to die. And yet, when they met, Esau forgave him. Pretty interesting. He didn't really deserve to be forgiven, but he was. And then what about Joseph? Is it possible that Joseph was alive when that happened? Because Joseph was one of the sons of Jacob, right? And if Joseph was alive when he saw Esau forgive, he saw Esau, that's a problem right there, forgive Jacob, is it possible that Joseph had it in his head when his brothers came to him in Egypt that he would forgive them? I don't know, but it's possible. They didn't have a Bible. There was no written word when Joseph was alive. So something made an image on him, on his heart. God had a relationship with that family for sure. And yet, Joseph says, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. You wanted to destroy a life, but God used that to save lives, including your lives. So many examples we could use. But then let's go with Jesus into the Garden of Gethsemane. He made him who knew no sin. Christ was like us in every way. He was tempted in every way. You have to realize he could have sinned. It was possible for him to sin. Because if it wasn't possible for him to sin, it wouldn't have been a temptation. And he wouldn't have been a man like us, right? We think sometimes he had an unfair advantage. I'm not sure. He was tempted in all ways like us, yet without sin. Whew, for 33 years. So he goes into the garden, and we know the famous prayer, not my will, but thine be done. If you could take this cup, take it, but if not, not my will, but thine be done. Right? And he became sin. And the way the Sanfords present it is he took on humanity's sin. And John Sanford asked us to imagine humanity across from Jesus in the garden as Jesus is kneeling down, because he's also God. He has the ability to transcend time. So when he's looking at a sinner across from him, he could look at all of humanity. As Jesus is kneeling down to pray, me and you are across from Jesus looking back at him. How hard would it be for him to say, I forgive you? And he's about to go to the cross, and he knows he's about to go to the cross. And the real key, and this is even, you know, written, pretty well-known quote, actually. The line between right and wrong is drawn right down the center of every man's heart. Right? So we all have the capacity to sin, and we all have the capacity to be obedient to God. So what if Jesus looked across the garden at us and said, in my humanity, I could have been just like you. And instead of Jesus being in the garden, what if it's us looking at the person who hurt us across from us and say, I don't think I could in the natural realm, but I understand in the spiritual realm that what you did to me, I'm capable of doing to somebody else. And because I can own that and recognize that, I'm going to forgive you. And here's the saying that we say a lot. 1 Corinthians 13:7 in the Amplified Version says, love believes the best. Really hard to do. Meaning, you did the best you could. As pitiful as that could sound in some of these situations of what people have done, like how could you talk to one of the parents of the Columbine shooters and say, well, you need to forgive them because they did the best they could, right? Like, wow, how hard is that? The truth is, if you were in their situation, you could have done the same thing. It's really hard to own that. It's really hard, but you got to imagine there was some mental illness in there too. And then what's the choice? To live in the bitterness and the hate? And, you know, sometimes you'll watch a news program and they're waiting for a verdict to come out and the people outside are just full of just so much pain. And we hope he burns. We hope he suffers more than he made our daughter suffer. And you can understand that because of how much we love our kids. And if somebody hurts our children, how could you not be upset about that? Of course, it's the hardest thing to see your child in any kind of pain. And yet, Jesus is saying, you can live in a higher realm than that. Not that it's not painful, but we are ambassadors for Christ. And be reconciled to God, the person who hurt me. I'm praying for you. Bless your enemies. Pray for those that despitefully use you. Try to pull the fuse out so they don't explode on somebody else. Through your actions, through your prayers, through the lack of responding in the way they expect you to respond. So I'm just going to read something that John wrote. Hopefully that summary helped you tune in a little bit. So this is what John wrote, John Sandford. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus drank the cup of our sins. He reaped in his own body all the consequences of every sin committed in the past, present, and future. He felt the full penalty of every murder, rape, perversion, lie, and betrayal. He bore this in his body to the extent that it caused his capillaries to burst. But that was just the physical part of what he was doing. He had never experienced separation from the Father. In the fullness of taking all our sin into himself, he then qualified to stand in our place. That's love, right? He qualified to stand in our place by taking on our sin. He was, for the first time, sin, and the Father could not look upon him. In the depth of his separation, he cried out, "Why have you forsaken me?" His agony was not just physical, but spiritual and emotional as well. Legally, because he was God and had the power to do so, Jesus transcended time and space and became us, every person, in the past, present, and future, and took into his body all the sins we had ever committed or would commit. Really not able to fathom that, are we? I mean, I can't even imagine taking on Hitler's sins. And that's just one person. Never mind Genghis Khan, whoever would even know how many guys that person killed. If he had not done that, the cross would have had little effect. He had to become, quote unquote, as we are, in order to take the punishment which the law prescribed. The prayer in which he became us is an integral part of the work of the cross. Not my will, but thine be done. It was an act of becoming us that nearly killed Jesus in the garden. This work fulfilled the legal requirement of the law that sin must result in death. God is a legal God, and he fulfilled his own law by accepting his substitutionary death as my own. I can then set in motion the same law of reaping and reap for myself his righteousness. And John goes on to say, that makes me a very happy person. But don't ever trample on the blood of Jesus. Don't ever take lightly the gift that he's given you, right? And the book of Hebrews talks about that. We won't get into that tonight, but I'll keep going. I think that was a duplicate. So what I want to do is a couple of things. First, I want to just go through like a little bit of analysis on the prayer, because you'll get to take the prayer home with you. And if you're watching online, we can email you the prayer. No worries. Easy to get. Just info@kingofkingswc.com, and we can send you any of the handouts that we're using tonight. All right, so let's just go through it a little bit in detail before we pray it. Thank you, Jesus, for taking forgiveness out of my hands. It's not an option. Do you believe that? All right. Well, then why is it so hard to do? Right? Because he doesn't deserve it. That's true. That person doesn't deserve it. They did something terrible, right? They betrayed you. You could go down a long list of things people have done that would cause us to have a hard time forgiving them. It's not an option. You simply said, I have to do it, yet I can't even do that, right? That's how we feel sometimes. Do for me what I cannot do for myself. That's a great prayer, isn't it? And grace, there's a definition of grace that's a little different from the popular one. Are we out of copies? Do we need one more copy? Oh, okay, good. There's a definition of grace that I like. I mean, the one that most people would say in the Sunday school class is unmerited favor, right? Grace is God's unmerited favor. But I like the one that says grace is God giving you supernatural ability to do the things that you can't do in the natural. You'll hear people say, well, I don't know how you're doing it. And you'll say, God gave me the grace for that season that I was in. And that's what forgiveness is like. He gives you the grace to do something that you don't have the ability. And I said it earlier, in our weakness, his strength is perfected. So this is one of those things of obedience. Do for me what I cannot do for myself. By myself, I cannot forgive. But for your sake, Jesus, I choose to do it as an act of my will. Now, again, you probably, maybe you've heard this, but there's a lot of new people watching online and those that maybe here are new also, but I've referred to a book called The Hiding Place many times, and it's also known well throughout Christianity. The book has sold millions of copies, and not everybody knows that there was a sequel to The Hiding Place by Corrie ten Boom called Tramp for the Lord, and we know that that word tramp can imply some pretty negative things, but she was just talking about traveling around the world and ministering. And I'm just going to read it to you pretty quickly. It won't take me long, but you may or may not know the scene. But even if you know the scene, it's worth revisiting it, or specifically around this part of this prayer. Do for me what I cannot do for myself. The definition of grace is God giving me a supernatural ability, what I can't do in the natural. But you have to ask for this a lot. So this is chapter 7 from the book Tramp for the Lord. It's taken from that book. It says, I was in a church in Munich the first time I saw him. You have to know that they were in a German prison camp because they were helping Jews escape Holland. Even though they were Christians, they were caught and they were sent to Ravensbrück, which was a prison camp run by the Germans. And we know it was no different than Auschwitz or any of the other death camps. But here she is, in a church preaching about forgiveness in Munich in 1947. So the war had ended, and she had a ministry, and she's invited to speak in Munich, and guess what her topic is? Forgiveness. I was in that church in Munich the first time I saw him, a balding older man with his hat between his hands. People were filing out of the church basement room where I had just spoken. It was 1947, and I had come from Holland to defeated Germany. What does that mean? A lot of people in Germany did not know what Hitler was doing while he was doing it. But after the war, they found out. And you can look at some of the films and some of these documentaries, and when the German people realized the scope of what was happening, it's just hard to imagine, right? Now, this property was founded by German missionaries. And this building was built while the war was going on. So this is a very present topic, right? Like this is, these are Christian people that run this mission that are bringing the news of the good news of the gospel. So clearly, they had to get over whatever guilt would have been on them just for being part of what happened. You would still feel as a German citizen that you didn't take direct part in it, but how could you still live with what happened would be really difficult. So why would this would be a very important topic in Germany to talk about forgiveness, right? So she says, 47, came to Holland from Holland to a defeated Germany with the message that God forgives. It was the truth that they needed most to hear in that bitter, bombed-out land. I gave them my favorite mental picture. Maybe because the sea is never far from a Hollander's mind, I like to think that that is where forgiven sins were thrown. When we confess our sins, I said, God cast them into the deepest ocean, gone forever. We know the verse, as far as the east is from the west. That's how far transgressions have been removed from us. And then she goes on to say, even though I can't find a scripture for it, I believe God places a sign there that says, no fishing allowed. The solemn faces in the audience stared back at me as I spoke about forgiveness, not quite daring to believe. There were never questions after a talk in Germany in 1947. People stood up in silence collected their wraps, and in silence left the room. That's when I saw him working his way forward against the others who were leaving the meeting. One moment I saw the overcoat and the brown hat, the next a blue uniform and a visored hat with its skull and crossbones. So you know that this is a real thing that happens. It's called a post-traumatic stress incident. I've met Navy SEALs that were still suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome, and they've trained the dogs that they give them a trained dog to walk with them so that if they're walking down the street and a car backfires and it reminds them of a shot, they could have a flashback like they're back on the battlefield. And the dog is trained to sense when that happens and will jump up on him and lick his hand to let him know the signal is you're not in your right mind right now. You're having a flashback. Imagine dogs can talk by licking your hand. That's miraculous to me that somebody figured that out. Miraculous. And if you've ever been in that trauma state, you know that you're not fully there. You literally feel like you're back in the scene. So that's happening to her. Completely unexpected. This guy starts walking up, and she recognizes he's one of the guards from the camp she was in. Not what she was expecting. It came back, the memories, with a rush. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights. The pathetic piles of dresses and shoes in the center of the floor. The shame of walking naked past this man. I could see my sister's frail form ahead of me, her ribs sharp beneath the parchment skin, thinking, Betsy, how thin you are. The place was Ravensbrück, and the man that was making his way forward had been a guard, one of the most cruel guards. Now he was in front of me, hand thrust out. And he said, a fine message, Fraulein. How good it is to know, as you say, that all our sins are at the bottom of the sea. And you might be saying, God is really mean. Like, why would he do this to this poor lady? He's not mean. He wanted her to see that there was still part of her heart that was having a hard time forgiving. You could do 100 seminars on forgiveness and still have another layer of the onion down there that hasn't been peeled yet. So, you know, if somebody sticks their hand out and you don't shake their hand, like, that's around the world, everybody knows that's an offense, isn't it? And I, Corey Ten Boom is saying, I had spoken so glibly of forgiveness in my talk, I just looked down and fumbled in my pocketbook rather than take that hand. He would not remember me, of course. How could he remember one prisoner among those thousands of women? But I remembered him and the leather crop swinging from his belt. I was face to face with one of my captors, and my blood seemed to freeze. He now says, with his hand extended, you mentioned Ravensbrook in your talk. I was a guard there. And then she says, no, he didn't remember me. Then he says, but since that time, I've become a Christian. I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things I did there, but I would like to hear it from your lips as well. Again, will you forgive me? And I stood there, I whose sins had again and again been forgiven, and I could not forgive. My sister Betsy had died in that place. Could he erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking? It could not have been many seconds that he stood there, hand held out, but to me it seemed hours as I wrestled with the most difficult thing I have ever had to do. For I had to do it. I knew that. The message that God forgives has a prior condition, that we forgive those who have sinned against us. Matthew 6:15. If you do not forgive men their trespasses, Jesus said, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. All right, so now she's just going to pull back from that scene for a minute and tell us her perspective. She said, I knew not only as a commandment of God, but as a daily experience. Since the end of the war, I had a home in Holland for victims of Nazi brutality. Those who were able to forgive their former enemies were able to return to the outside world and rebuild their lives. No matter what the physical scars, those who nursed their bitterness remained invalids. Drop the mic. Like, really, like, think about it. You stay crippled in that area that you're holding on to that unforgiveness. So you might say, well, they don't deserve it. You're right, but you didn't deserve to get saved either. And you don't know the horrible thing that was done to me, and you're right, I don't, and I can't relate specifically to it. But there is consequences to that decision not to forgive. You're carrying this bitterness inside. And she said, those who nursed their bitterness remained invalids. It was as simple and as horrible as that. And even though I knew that, I still stood there with a coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is not an emotion. I knew that too. Forgiveness is an act of the will. And the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. That's worth repeating. The will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. Here's what she's praying as she's fumbling around in her pocketbook. I don't know what you ladies have in there, but there's a whole lot of stuff. Jesus, help me! I prayed silently. I can at least lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling. And so, woodenly and mechanically, I thrust my hand into the one stretched out to me. And as I did, now you got to remember, this is not like a wild, charismatic Corrie ten Boom used to prophetic dreams and speaking in tongues, right? She's a comes from a much more conservative background, right? But it doesn't matter. As I did, an incredible thing took place. The current, like electrical current, started in my shoulder, raced down my arm, sprang into our joined hand, and then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. By faith. Do it by faith. I forgive you, I cried, with all my heart. I forgive you, my brother. For a long moment, we grasped each other, the former guard and the former prisoner. I had never known God's love so intensely as I did then. But even so, I realized this was not my love. I had tried that and didn't have the power. It was the power of the Holy Spirit. As recorded in Romans 5:5, the love of God shed abroad in our hearts, shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which is given to us. That helps me. Her sister, Betsy, that died in the prison, before she died, she was being beaten by one of the guards, and she said, I'm giving you a summary of this now, but she said to Corrie, After the war, we're going to have to open up a home for the people that survived the war. And Corey is thinking, man, you know, you're being beaten to death and you're thinking about what's going to happen after the war. And then Corey realized she wasn't talking about the prisoners that escaped. She was talking about the German prison guards. And she describes the home to Corey. And she said, it's a big mansion. There's gardens in the front. There's a big spiral staircase in the center. And after the war ends, and Betsy passed, but Corey lives, a woman came up to Corey in Holland and said, I have four sons. Three of them have come back from the war. And the fourth one, when the fourth one comes back, I want to donate a home to you for the house. And then she got a note one day and said, my fourth son arrived home. Would you come and see the house? And she gets driven there, and there's a long driveway, and it turns out it's a 56-room estate that the lady's going to donate to them to use as a home. Big gardens, spiral staircase in the center. And as they're walking out there, Corey realizes that her sister saw this house when she was still in Ravensbrück. And the lady said, yeah, I'd like to bring you inside. And Corey says, is there a spiral staircase in the center? And is there cutouts in the walls like what her sister saw? And the lady looked at her like, have you been here before? And she said, someone I know has been here before. So that's where they took both the German guards and these people that she's saying. That was the home she was talking about. I know that if they chose to linger in their bitterness, they couldn't re-enter society. They remain crippled in that area. The devil's not that good. Don't let him do that to you. Don't let him disempower you, because we have a limited time here. And every day counts. And I'm just not giving him that much credit that he's better than God, because he's not. Anyway, that's Corey Ten Boom. Let's go back to the prayer of forgiveness for a minute. So just to recap that part, thank you, Jesus, for taking forgiveness out of my hands. It's not an option. You simply said, I have to do it. This is the beginning of the prayer. Yet I can't even do that. Do for me what I cannot do for myself. By myself, I cannot forgive. But for your sake, Jesus, I choose to do it as an act of my will. I give you any right that I felt was mine to throw people, even myself, into a debtor's prison. Okay, good with that? What's that picture remind you of, a debtor's prison? Right? You're angry with them. So how does that translate? If you're keeping them in a debtor's prison, how does it translate at Thanksgiving if it's one of your family members and they come over? You might be a little chilly. You might be like not exactly hugging them around the table. Or if they say, how are things going? You say, fine. And they're like, is anything wrong? No. Liar. I'm going to punish you by withholding my love. But they're oblivious. They don't even know they hurt you because you didn't say anything to them, maybe. I don't know. There's a whole bunch of scenarios here, right? Why not better? My boss used to say, put the skunk on the table. Right? Let's just get this thing out and talk about it and let's be done with it, right? Don't keep carrying the skunk in your backpack. This is what this prayer is saying. I give you any right I felt was mine to throw people, even myself, into a debtor's prison. Lord, I release them and I forgive them for what they did. I stand here before you now as my counselor, and this is if you were counseling with somebody and you were praying with them. I'm standing here before you now as my counselor, as witness, and I confess that they owe me nothing. Boy, is that profound. Right? The way you know if they owe you nothing is what happens the next time you see them. And think about going down the street, and you see them before they see you. And what's your reaction? Turn the other way and walk away as fast as you can and hope they don't see you. They still owe you something. That you haven't zeroed out the balance. Go up to them and say hi, but not give them the time of day. There's still a balance. You're still getting a statement every month, and there's still a balance that they owe you. How about running up to them and hugging them and saying, good to see you. I've been praying for you. God's going to put a revival in your life. You're going to get downloads from the Holy Ghost. And then you'll apologize to me. That's what it means to bless your enemies and pray for those that despitefully use you. See how hard this is? Instead of picturing them twisting in the wind, you see them on their knees crying out before the Lord, saved, sanctified, set free from that prison that would allow them to do what they did to you. I confess they owe me nothing. I got the statement in the mail and it's a zero balance. I think I did that one right. Wow, this is powerful. It says, I give you the right to hold them accountable for their actions. Not my job anymore to hold them accountable. I give that right to you. Lord, dismantle the prison that I build for others. It's a real prayer, isn't it? You could tell this one's been worked on a bit. Release me from trying to make up for my mistakes that I've made, the prison of trying to be worthy. You alone are my worth. I give you my feelings of unworthiness. Help me to forgive myself for what I did or did not do. Help me to forgive myself. Say it twice, man. Because this is really hard. Can we just do that for a minute? Just think about how you might be holding yourself in a prison. Angry because, you know, each one of us, we're the only ones that really knows all the details. We're good at hiding things from other people, but if we can't forgive ourselves, then we're disallowing God from doing it. We think we're better than God. He's willing to forgive us, and we're not. Like, no, that's out of order. We have to be willing to look yourself in the mirror and say, I forgive you. You did the best you could with what you had at the time. Wouldn't do it again now. This is a hard one. Release me to receive the forgiveness that you want to give. I give you the right to hold me accountable for my actions or lack thereof. You know what to require of me and of others and when to give mercy. I release you, God, from the expectations I've had of you. Whoa, wait a minute. You're angry at God? Yeah, some of us are. I had expectations from you. But your ways are not my ways. I can never wrap my mind around forgiveness. I don't understand it and don't know how it works. But when you didn't do what I expected or wanted of you, I became angry and resented you. Nobody here would do that. That's the people in the other church. No. You can resent God. That's not good though, right? I forgive you, Lord. Now, doesn't that sound silly? I forgive you, Lord. He can't sin, but that's not what the prayer is saying. It's for what I perceived. I forgive you, Lord, for what I perceived to be sins of omission on your part. Forgive me, Lord, for my anger and resentment, and help me accept you and your ways. Teach me your ways. I often want to hurt those who hurt like I do. Say amen. That's part of our nature. Hurt people. Profound, isn't it? Okay, there it is. Sorry. I want them to know the enormity of what they do to me, and I want them to be sorry. This is one prayer. There's about 50 prayers in here, isn't there? Like every sentence is a whole prayer. But that is vengeance, and that is your territory. Forgive me for taking your place. Forgive my desire for vengeance. Thank you that I do not have to pretend it's all right or pretend it does not hurt or matter. Thank you for listening to my expression of pain. My hurt and my sin matters to you so much that you provided forgiveness for my healing. These are all really worth dwelling on. Lord, wash my mind, spirit, and emotions of the acid of pain, resentment, and anger, and clothe me in your righteousness. I know my emotions will heal in time. In time, I'll be able to forgive emotionally as well. This is powerful, right? So, like, she's extending her hand by faith, and she feels that warmth. But don't be upset with yourself if you get a breakthrough and then you still find yourself having echoes after it happens, right? That's very normal for people, and you just keep bringing it back to the cross. You just keep saying, no, that's under the blood. That's washed away. That's that old person. They don't owe me anything. I've had to do that enough times. I'll be able to feel the emotion of being forgiven and of extending forgiveness. Until then, Lord, keep mending my wounded spirit and bruised emotions. Yeah, that's a heck of a prayer. That's just the front page of one piece of paper. All those prayers were all part of one prayer that the Sanfords use in their ministry. And we have, I want to say hundreds of them, probably do have hundreds by now, right, Easter? So let me just make this real for a minute, and let's think about a well-known story in the Bible. I won't, you know, go through chapter and verse with you, because I'm guessing most of you know the story of Joseph in the Bible. And, you know, there's quite a bit there that would require a lot of time to look through all the verses. But if we could just talk at a higher level and think about what was going on in his life, and what might we read between the lines about what was going on in his life. Because we really know that he's a hero, right? Everybody would agree that he has to rank as one of the most heroic people in the Bible, even for what I already quoted in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, when he confronted his brothers, right? And he said, "But I'm forgiving you. You guys, you know, I have the right to kill you. I'm second in command here. You should be toast right now, but you're not." And there's a lot that went into that. So let's just use our imagination for a minute, okay? You willing to do that? It's 8:29, so I know I don't have much more attention span here. Let's just use our imaginations for a minute. And Joseph goes from being, I would say, treated badly by his brothers while he was still at home, right? Because it was obvious that the father, Jacob, loved Joseph more. Why? Just help me out with the Bible here a little bit. Because the father, that was the main person he wanted to marry, was Joseph's mom. Thank you. Good job. Give her a gold star. So, but then we'll do performance orientation and take the gold star away. Just kidding. Now, the brothers took it out on Joseph. Like, it's my fault that he loves my mother? And then who was the other child of that mother? Benjamin. And what happened to his mom when Benjamin was born? Ah, that's trauma. Dying. He lost his mother. So now the other brothers can pick on both of them, and there's nobody there to protect them. Their mother's not there. So they're growing up. Now, you could argue that when he has this dream, he should have been smart enough to know not to go tell his brothers, right? But when you're dealing with rejection, constantly dealing with rejection, it's pretty hard, right? And I don't think there was any animosity when he said, oh, I had this dream, and you're all going to bow down to me someday. Like, you know, that sounds completely inept right now, but you weren't there, right? Like, I'm willing to say that he just hadn't thought that part through. But he was looking for some kind of identity to feel important, because they were constantly rejecting him. So what happens? They sell him into slavery, right? But they were going to kill him first, and they throw him down in a pit, and he could hear them planning, right? Like, wow, what is that about? Like, this, no fault of my own, you know, he could have been saying to himself, like, it's not my fault that I was getting picked on or that my father favored me. I maybe should have been more discerning about it, but man, come on, like, cut me some slack too, right? And then they decide, you know, they have a little relapse of a conscious, and they decide to sell him, maybe with the plan that they're going to go back and get him. I don't know. It's a long story. But now he's a slave. Wow. Right? You're sold into slavery. And even in slavery, he still prospers. He gets put in charge of Potiphar's house. And Potiphar, at one point, I'm a financial advisor, so this really rung true to me. Potiphar says, here's my checkbook. Do whatever you want. I trust you. I know you're not going to spend a nickel out of line. That never happens around here, right? So, like, this guy had favor on his life, and yet he's approached by Potiphar's wife. He doesn't commit the sin, but he gets thrown in jail. And if anybody would have a right to be bitter about being thrown in jail, it's like, really? Like, this is what I get for serving God and doing the right thing. And yet he still keeps going. He gets put in charge of the jail. And then he starts interpreting dreams in the jail, right? And you guys know all these stories, right? He comes out and he interprets the dream of Pharaoh. What was that dream? Bible scholars, you can't answer because you already answered. You can't answer. You can't answer. Thank you. She's an elder. That's cheap too, but we'll let you talk. There's going to be a famine. Oh, good for you. You're allowed to read it. It's an open book test. You know, keep it open on your computer. Oh, good. Yeah, look at that. Perfect timing. There's going to be a famine. A lot of detail there. But because of that correct interpretation of that dream, Joseph gets elevated, right? And you might hear the title of a message, From the Pit to the Palace. From zero to hero. Well, he's in the palace. And he's having lunch one day in the cafeteria, and one of the Egyptians comes up and says, hey, you're not from around here, are you? No. Where are you from? Pretty far away. Any family there? Yeah, I got family there. He says, well, isn't that where you said there was going to be a famine? Like, don't you think you should send for them and bring them here? And Joseph's like, did you see the game last night? Who won that game? That's what we do. We just want to avoid things that are painful. There's a flight mechanism that kicks in. It's like, huh, family? Bad scene. He named one of his children, I've forgotten my family. That's pretty profound. That's a deep hurt. Boy, I'll tell you, that's a wound. So it's not so much what he did, it's what he failed to do. And Corrie ten Boom, you could argue, is kind of in that same boat, because she would have said, oh, my heart's clean. I'm teaching conferences on forgiveness. And yet, if you don't go to the mountain, God brings the mountain to you. So you don't go back and get your family. God brings your family to you. And guess who's not with them? Benjamin. The one brother that he would have wanted to see, right? Why? Well, maybe he looks like his mom. That's the only connection back to my mother now, right? He's a human being. And it's like, well, what about Benjamin? Well, you 11 lowlife show up. No, he didn't say that. But like the one I want to see, I guess it would have been 10. Benjamin would have been the 11th, right? So, you know, it's a long story. But the evidence that there's so much pain in his heart is when they come, right? And there's all these little wonderful nuances. He sits them all in the birth order at the table, and they're looking at each other like, this is too weird, man. This is no coincidence. So how's your father? How's your brother? Where is he anyway, right? And then when they bring him, he just bursts out wailing in tears, right? Like, that's the pain that's been stuffed and stuffed and stuffed down inside. Because God hated him? No. Because God loved him. Did God hate Corrie ten Boom? No. He loved her enough to help her see what she couldn't see. And that's what this whole inner healing process is about. That's what all of this transforming the inner man and bitter root judgments. And I mean, there's 100 different terms that you'll hear us use that all tie back into this one. Maybe you could call it a journey of healing. When the Lord said, pick up your cross daily, that must mean that there's another thing that we can be working on without becoming invalids and staring at our navel all day, right? No, we're going to engage, but we're going to keep our ear open to, Lord, how can we be fine-tuning our walk with you? How can I become more of a disciple of yours today? So I guess the last one I would say is there's real consequences to not forgiving. Okay, and I'll give you one more quick overview, and then we'll pray this prayer, but we'll just pray it through so that we're offering it up to the Lord. But I quote this story often because study the life of David as a worship leader. But boy, it's profound that he was so strong in some parts of his life. When Saul was in the cave, his men were saying, go kill him, here's your enemy. He said, no, I won't touch God's anointed, right? But there's something about, like, you could almost argue about where we are today, almost two full years into COVID lockdown, right? And people are just completely frayed at the ends of their nerves, right? F-R-A-Y-E-D, like a thread that just frayed, like, they don't have a lot of capacity left for stress. It's been so stressful. And that was David. He's been on the run. He knew that he was supposed to be the king, and he's living in caves, and he's running from Saul, and it's got to be brutally hard. So he goes from writing all these amazing psalms about the faithfulness of God and showing his men that he won't kill his enemy to one offense with Nabal, and he tells the men, strap on your swords. By the morning, this guy's whole family's going to be wiped out. That was the straw. Boom. He's nuclear Sicilian in that moment. Dead. And this is not good, right? And who comes to intercept him? A little louder. Holy Spirit. Yeah, that's this beautiful representation. All the ladies love it when I say this, because she's got the discernment to speak to him and say, you have this amazing reputation, David, of being a godly man. You're about to ruin it. And you could go into that more on your own, but he says, thank God that you intercepted me, or by morning you would have no sons left. But besides that, she says, you would have had a mark on your record that could have disqualified you from the call in your life. You're going to let the anger over one offense do that to you? You're going to let your emotions hijack you and take your full destiny away. And that's what Saul did. He goes in and inquires of a witch, right? Like, wait a minute. He disqualified himself from being the leader, right? So this is not a minor thing we're talking about here. This is a cornerstone principle that if we want to serve God to the full potential, any area of unforgiveness we're holding in our hearts is going to act against that, right? You know, in the epistle Peter wrote, he says, lest your prayers be hindered. That's sobering, isn't it? All right, I'm wanting to cheer you guys up. Go ahead. Tom wants to say something. Use a nice, loud, projecting voice. Please, yes. You guys stand up, okay? Because I want to read this out loud together, and I want you to know that we're getting close to finishing.
Everybody's doing the best that they can.
That's right.
Yeah, right. What about that little 6-year-old boy who had to go down to the bottom of the steps in the basement to stand there to wait for his dad to come down and hit him with a belt?
Right.
What about the 12-year-old boy who said something in the kitchen and his dad knocked him across the floor, and as he's laying there in the blood on the floor, he looks at his mom for compassion, and she said, if you grow up to be half the man your father is, you'll be lucky.
A little closer to your mouth here.
You'll be lucky. Mm-hmm. That was me. They worked as hard as they can to provide for us. There was absolutely no love, and if you stepped out of line, you got it. You got it bad. And I think I got the worst because of the youngest. But it was so bad that when my mom died 7 years ago, some of my brothers refused to go to her funeral. They just couldn't forgive her for not standing up to my dad. But after the funeral, her youngest brother came up to me and said, isn't your mother the most wonderful person on the face of the earth? And I said, you gotta be kidding me. You know, I had walked through forgiveness, but you gotta be kidding me. He goes, no, you don't get it. She was doing the best that she could. When they were young, their father was a raging alcoholic. He would work in the coal mines 5 days a week, and on Friday he would go and get drunk. And he's going to have to come home, and he's going to have to take it out on one of the kids. All that frustration of his entire life was going to be poured out on one of these kids. When my mom was 12, she stood up to him because he was not going to get at those boys. And he would knock her to the floor and then go over to the potbelly stove where the logs were sitting, pick up a log, and beat her all of his frustrations, all of his anger, everything for that entire week, he poured out onto that woman. How could she stand up to my dad? She was doing the best that she could. And I just went out in the rain from the funeral and just prayed forgiveness to heaven. And I just asked Jesus at that point to wrap your arms around her, Lord, and just tell her I love her and forgive her. She was doing the best she could.
Yeah. And look, here's the deal. You might as well live as if they were doing the best they could. Right? Like, why get caught in that whole equation? No way, they couldn't have been. Well, look, you have no idea what kind of pain they were in and what would have caused that. Amen? Amen. Let's read this out loud together, okay? There's something about speaking it into the atmosphere that allows it to stick. Like I said, those of you at home, in fact, why don't we say it out loud and then pause so the people at home that don't have this can say it, okay? Thank you, Jesus, for taking forgiveness out of my hands. It's not an option. You simply said, I have to do it. Yet I can't even do that. Do for me what I cannot do for myself. By myself, I cannot forgive. But for your sake, Jesus, I choose to do it as an act of my will. Now just stop for a second, everybody, and just think about who you might need to forgive. Allow the Holy Spirit to bring that person or people into your mind. And don't restrict it to just family members. It could be church people that you've met over the years or teachers. There's so many different ways you could have been hurt this way. It's different for each one of us. All right, ready? Let's start again. I give you any right I felt was mine to throw people, even myself, into a debtor's prison. Lord, I release them. I forgive them for what they did. Now just sit there for a second and dwell on that about the people that you imagined in your mind. Okay, Jesus, I stand here before you now as my counselor, as witness, and confess that they owe me nothing. It's worth repeating. They owe me nothing. Picture that person in your mind and put a zero balance in that account. They owe me nothing. No more statements coming in the mail. I give you the right to hold them accountable for their actions. Lord, dismantle the prison I build for others. Release me from trying to make up for mistakes I've made. The prison of trying to be worthy. You alone are my worth. I give you my feelings of unworthiness. Help me forgive myself for what I did or did not do. Help me to forgive myself. I mean, that's so important, you just got to say it twice. I give you my feelings of unworthiness. Help me to forgive myself. I'm sorry, I repeated myself. I'm sorry. My bad. Yeah. There we go. Release me to forgive. I'm sorry. The forgiveness you want me to give. Oh, I must have had a post-traumatic stress moment there. Sorry. Let's say that again. Release me to receive the forgiveness you want to give. Sorry. I give you the right to hold me accountable for my actions or lack of actions. You know what to require of me and others and when to give mercy. I release you, God, from the expectations I've had of you. Your ways are not my ways. I can never wrap my mind around forgiveness. Stop there for a minute, right? Just recognize what we just said. We don't have to try to fully understand it all. Just accept it as a kingdom principle. I do not understand it, and I don't know how it works. When you did not do what I expected or wanted of you, I became angry and resented you. I forgive you, Lord, for what I perceived to be sins of omission on your part. Forgive me, Lord, for my anger and resentment, and help me accept you and your ways. Teach me your ways. I often want to hurt those who hurt me to hurt like I do. I said that wrong too. Let's say that again. I often want those who hurt me to hurt like I do. Can you believe I said I often want to hurt those? That was like a Freudian slip there. Forgive me, Lord. Here we go. I want them to know the enormity of what they do to me, and I want them to be sorry. But that is vengeance, and that's your territory. Forgive me for taking your place. Forgive my desire for vengeance. Thank you that I do not have to pretend it is all right, or pretend it doesn't hurt or matter. Thank you for listening to my expression of pain. My hurt and my sin matters to you so much that you provided forgiveness for my healing. Lord, wash my mind, my spirit, and my emotions of the acid of pain, resentment, and anger, and clothe me in your righteousness. I know, say it again, I know my emotions will heal in time. One more time. I know my emotions will heal in time. In time, I'll be able to forgive emotionally as well. I will be able to feel the emotion of being forgiven and of extending forgiveness. Until then, Lord, keep mending my wounded spirit and bruised emotions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Don't you feel better? No, I need prayer. So we will have prayer at the altar tonight if you don't have to rush out. I just want to speak a prayer over you, okay? Could you lift your hands one minute? You guys, I just want to bless you. Lord, I just thank you that we have the capacity to handle difficult things, that you open up our spirit, even when it's hard to remember some of the things. And for anybody that is concerned about the emotions that you're feeling, it does happen that when we go back into that trauma, there can be pain, so you need to have other people around you. So, Lord, we need those people we can trust in our lives, that we can go to with deep secrets and know that they're the right people for us to talk to, that can pray through things with us and help walk us back there with you. But I thank you for such a group of people that are willing to extend themselves into this area and say, I know he loves me, but he doesn't want me stuck where I am right now. That he wants me to be more like him. So any baggage that's still in my life, in my heart, any areas of unforgiveness that hasn't been revealed to me yet, Lord, I ask you, reveal it to me. I know you'll do it with grace, and I want to respond with grace as well. I want to respond with mercy. I want to recognize that you've been faithful to me, and I will be faithful to others. And Lord, we command that lie in our heart that says we're not enough to be broken in Jesus' name, and that we will be your ambassadors and ministers of reconciliation in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all. I know we ran late tonight, but have a great night, and grab hold of this information.